for having me. I play cello with this wonderful family who I am newly a part of.
Hi, my name is Mariana. I'm from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, and I live in Woodstock after living 2 years in New York City. And I'm a singer-songwriter. I'm here with my family from Brazil, also living here in New York City and upstate area. So yeah, here we go.
So my name is Gabriel Barcelos, and I'm new here, upstate. I live in Rio de Janeiro.
Yeah, I'm Adriana Figueiredo Barcelos.
Yeah.
And I am a singer, songwriter, filmmaker, writer, actress, and I'm living in New York City for 2 years and a half, and getting to know each time more upstate New York, mainly Ulster County. I'm very in love with this region, and we just sang one of my songs that I write, and actually these songs are healing songs because I hear them and they are here, they come through me to share this good energy and bring good feelings, healings, and better connection to nature and with the force of light. So I'm happy to share this with you here today.
Yeah, me too. I'm so happy to be here. My name is Vicente Barcelos. I am a director of TV. I work in Rio de Janeiro at the TV Global. And I'd like to know, I'm so happy that to be here. Thank you so much for this wonderful experience.
Yeah, so
Fernanda can speak in Portuguese.
Yeah.
Adriana translates.
Meu nome é Fernanda.
My name is Fernanda.
Moro no Rio de Janeiro.
I live in Rio de Janeiro.
Estou passando uma temporada aqui.
I'm visiting here. Well, and she is a great raw vegan living food chef.
Yeah.
Great food. So what we do with music, she does with her cooking. It's really amazing.
We have to go into the kitchen sometime with you.
Yeah.
She's cooking in Ulster County area, so she's feeding some people. Some people are feeling healthier now with her around.
So George.
I'm sweating bullets. It's like 9 million degrees out today and very humid, so like this. I want to just welcome you to Woodstock, and your music is stunning, just beautiful, and it's already healing me. And
me too.
This is a good thing because you know, we got to know each other a little bit over lunch just earlier today, and we covered a broad range of subjects, from Brazil, life in Brazil with the urban reality juxtaposed with the native or the indigenous people and the variety of issues that come along with that. And the sense I'm getting is that your family is bringing the two together in a healing kind of a way. In a mutual appreciation and more, I think what I was getting is that a deeper appreciation of the indigenous knowledge and what that has to offer to our civilization today. And your music is a part of this reflection.
Yeah.
Am I getting this right?
Yeah, right. Very right.
If there's anything you can, you know, bring out the for our English audience, we're going to be leaning on Adriana quite a bit here, so, but anything you can contribute, you know,
yeah,
what are your thoughts?
Yeah, that's right. I think when we connect to the force of light, to the force of nature, of the earth, we start to be more indigenous in our hearts, in our minds. And in my life journey, I get to get in touch with indigenous cultures that made me connect better to the real reality of life. That we have to learn to be healthy, actually. We have to spread the good energy. We have to breathe well. We have to sing beautiful songs. We have to express the best that we have in our heart every moment. And besides the music, I'm also a filmmaker, and one film that I made called Taina Khan, the Big Star, that got some awards in film festivals, brought me even more in touch with indigenous cultures, and I could see that we need to exchange our cultures. Like, we are urban people, we live in cities, but we in order to live well and to live healthy, it's good to get in touch with people that really can live a daily life based in real connection to the forces that make us alive. So we are here because we have the beautiful sun over there shining for us every day. So we breathe the oxygen that is brought to us from the sun. The sun with the trees, the leaves, makes us be here alive breathing. So this thing that we take for granted, this is something that makes us alive, and we have to praise this force and share the beautiful energy that it brings to us. And sometimes you just say, oh, the sun is there another day, but exactly, that's it. The sun is there, it's another day in our lives. We're in this journey throughout this universe following great star, the sun. So all these things comes to me and connects me more with the force of Pachamama, the force of the earth, the force of the sun, of the moon and the stars and the forest. And this connects me with the indigenous understanding of life. And actually all civilization came from indigenous groups, just that we lost this connection.
I spent quite a long time with immersed in the culture of the Seneca and the Mohawk people of New York, this region here. And the elders would often speak to the connection to our environment, that we're born from it and that we live in it. But as I'm listening to your music and your philosophy here, what I'm moved by is what my elders would say is that music is within all of us. We're made out of it, and that the heart is the drum.
Beautiful.
And the breath and the drum, is like the wind in the trees, is the breath that we have. And our voices is the singing, and that connects us to, say, the birds and this kind of thing. So that everything that we're made out of, everyone is music. And as a musician myself, one of my visions is that I came to is that we all come into this earth walk. We all get born into this, plopped on planet Earth as babies and crying and growing and learning and all this kind of thing. But we have a soul or a spirit, but also a song. And I struggled with this for a long time as a songwriter, looking for that new song, looking for that new melody, something new, something different, something unusual, something that hasn't been done before. And by gosh, that's just like impossible. It's a very, almost unattainable task. And then about 5 years ago, I came off with this idea that, well, I only have one song. And all of the songs that I write are just parts. of my song, if you follow. And
yeah. I completely agree with this idea. And it's interesting to see artists work, and that's why we say, oh, this sounds like that artist, because it has a characteristic quality. So the combination of all songs from the same artist, they connect.
Yes. John Lennon is recognizable no matter who's playing the song, or Jobim and his music is recognizable because of that vibration that these individuals will bring through. Yeah. And so I don't beat myself up quite so much anymore about being original, because I'm finding I'm slowing down, and in slowing down, the melodies are becoming more clear. I broke my finger, so I'm a lot slower too, for that reason. But getting back to your journey here, I'm fascinated with your film, because I do manage the local Upstate Films theater here, and I would be delighted to float to my superiors your movie, and I think we should show it.
Wonderful.
As you know, your family has taken one of our own from Woodstock into it. You know, there's a depth here that brings our two nations, Brazil and the United States, a little closer.
Sure.
And I like that.
Yeah, it'll be wonderful for sure. And we can show other indigenous films also from other filmmakers, indigenous or non-indigenous,
uh-huh.
showing indigenous cultures, different cultures of indigenous people from in the first person, so they telling the story or telling the story in the first person. So it's good to be able to share this this work,
mm-hmm.
and share these other cultures, so that we get to know, because United States and Brazil have a lot in common. They were indigenous lands, and then European people came, and then African people came. So it's good to see how was different approaches, get to know these different cultures. Yeah, it's wonderful.
Another thing one of my elders would often say is that it was always the artists and the musicians that were the healers in their communities in ancient times. And to this day, I find it interesting that the real artists, the real musicians, that give from their centers, often are the ones that aren't the big pop stars. You know what I'm saying? They're the ones that move us the most with their melodies, I think. You know, I don't know where I'm going with that. But real briefly, the first song that you opened with for myself and our audience, what was the theme?
Yes, Pachamama is how Earth and the force of Earth is called by the people, the Andean people.
Mm-hmm.
So Inca Empire, the Quechua people call this force of the Earth Pachamama. So this is a song asking for healing from the force of the earth, so that we can heal ourselves. And by singing the song, we are already healing, because we are connecting. So what we say in the songs are like prayers. So these songs are prayers, actually. So you can sing, but as you're saying the beautiful things, it becomes a spell, you know? So it's a prayer, a spell,
yeah.
And then you connect. So it came to that purpose, to connect.
Would you like to? Do you have another one?
Yeah.
They have lots more.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Which one?
Vicente.
Yeah.
You have something on your computer that we might be able
to show later a part of the film of Adriano.
Okay. Great. Great. We'll let you hear that.
Yeah.
Thank you. substituted with eggplant and porcini mushroom or some other thing, and made all these dishes, and we did pizzas, soups, and salad, but nobody knew that we had no meat in our soup, because we didn't advertise it. And it was interesting that half the town boycotted us when they found out that there was no meat. But it didn't matter, because our clientele was very loyal, and we had a lot of tourists in the summer, so we never had a slow season. We were always well supported. But I want to address, I'm sorry, I forgot your name again.
Fernanda,
that cooking for people is a very high thing, you know, and it's not really respected, at least not in this country. So the thing that always used to come to me is that you're feeding people, you're putting something in their bodies. How much more responsibility can you have with someone's life? Industrial work when I was a teenager. I worked in a factory. And I suffered acute toxemia, blood poisoning, from asbestos, trichloroethylene, and a variety of other chemicals. And nothing could heal me. Doctors that antibiotics do not work on chemicals.
Actually, it acts as the opposite. You get even more poisoned, right?
Yes, and out of desperation, my girlfriend, we were very young. I was only 18 years old. We went to the health food store and we got a book called Back to Eden. And in this book, I should drop the name, Jethro Klotz. Jethro Klotz was a physician from the 1930s. Who studied with the Native Americans, the indigenous of Wisconsin. And those herbal remedies saved my life.
Food that she cooks. Actually, she doesn't cook, together in Fundação Oswaldo Cruz, in Rio de Janeiro.
Que é projeto feito por uma doutora.
It's a project created by a physician.
Que é pioneira da comida crua no Brasil.
She's called Ana Branca, she's the pioneer.
Ana Branca, Maria Luisa.
Ana Branca is the sister.
Sorry.
It's Maria Luisa.
Maria Luisa Branca, okay. Maria Luisa Branca is her name. And she's the pioneer in this kind of food, nesse tipo de comida, não é?
Programa que ajuda as pessoas a comerem bem, um programa gratuito de um ano e meio, que é um fundamento na promoção da saúde, onde a pessoa se cura através da alimentação, previne doenças através da alimentação.
It's a project that takes a year and a half that people learn how to eat well and prepare their food. To avoid health problems.
Uh-huh.
Mas ela curou em mano, foi isso? Foi assim que eu chamo assim? Ela curou.
Ela ajudou a se curar, ela ajudou a trabalhar com a mão.
So, just, I said the name of the sister first, Ana Branco, is the sister of Maria Luisa Branco, who is the physician, but both were very sick before they started to go into this kind of food. And then they healed themselves, and then the physician, the sister that is the physician one, she developed this project so that trains people to heal themselves by eating and cooking
yes.
the right things.
So my question is, I was brought to this kind of food and consciousness was because of a crisis. What got you involved with this kind of thing?
Saúde. Por que que você se interessou por isso?
É, eu não cozinhava, comecei a cozinhar quando eu comecei a namorar com o Gabriel. E a gente entrou nesse curso porque eu sou bióloga também, então eu achei muito interessante esse assunto que já estava aqui na minha vida.
So, she said that she started.
Ela não cozinhava.
She didn't cook before. She was not a cook, but she became interested with this kind of food when they got together, and he was interested in this kind of food. So, by this relationship, she started to be interested more, and then she knew about this project. They engaged in this project because actually, and she's a biologist, so it's a kind of improving her knowledge. And so instead of being sick first, trying not to be sick at all, you know. And actually, we as a family, we went to a retreat for a week with one of the teachers of this project in Brazil, and we improved a lot our health. It was great. And then they both were, Mariana and Gabriel were already interested in this kind of food.
Mm-hmm.
And then they really got together and went together to this training. And she became the chef one. So she became the chef of the family.
This is something that's very beautiful, and that is that you're a family and you're doing things together. And I come from a very large family. I have seven older brothers and one sister, and I don't even know where most of them are anymore. My parents are gone, they've crossed over, and the younger generation, my children are grown and doing their thing. But there's not this sense that I'm getting from you, which is, you know, you have a bond that is very engaging. And my question to Gabriel, as the American in the group here, am I sensing something here that you experience?
families are more together, like children stay in parents' home for like, I don't know, 30 years old sometimes.
30?
Yeah.
I think that.
Well, well, it depends on also financial crisis, you know. Sometimes you cannot leave and parents help their children.
Yes.
No, that happens a lot, really. And it's like, also because in Brazil, the jobs, the easy jobs that American gets, like, oh, I'm going to be a waitress or a hostess or nanny, and like, I'm going to pay my rent while I'm studying, things like that, doesn't happen in Brazil. It's, in Brazil, it's very class, like, class is very divided, like, which job you should go. So in this way, I feel like families also stay more in the houses. But that happens in all the classes.
Yeah, yeah, what I would say is that it's very difficult to be independent financially in Brazil. To be a person to become independent financially takes a long time.
Uh-huh.
It's not some, with some, there are some exceptions, but it's usually it's difficult, so people get together more. But in our case, we could be living in the same house and not relating much. But now she's not living with us. I mean, we are living actually in two different countries, but we keep the connection because we have the same interests and one helps the other. So there are some things that, I mean, since they're very young, they started to tell me things, give me advices, and I listen to them, you know, so I suspect.
But that's a connection that we have with native people also, having this, like, caring the family, you know, like caring the message of the family. I feel that in our family, what I can say from my family is that our inspiration is from the native.
Interesting.
And also we, there are other people, like friends, they become part of the family too. So it's this family thing, it's something that spreads.
Well, you know, I have a little anecdote to share with you, and that is on the Mohawk community I lived with, I had an elder, a grandma, and that's a term of respect. She wasn't my grandma, but we called her grandma, and Grandma Ida. And I couldn't arrive at her home and not eat. And it didn't matter what time of day. If I tried to like roll into the driveway at 3 o'clock in the morning and just sort of just sleep in my car until morning, be respectful, that kind of thing, Grandma would come out and start banging on my window. Get up! I don't care what time it is. You're going to come in and you're going to eat. You drove a long way. And we come in and it would be 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, and we're eating and visiting and talking and sharing stories. And this is something that I didn't grow up with. And it's a very welcoming kind of a thing. And so I can see how that contact with the indigenous will bring those, that kind of value, you know, to you. And the other one is in the indigenous community I'm familiar with, the old people are revered, and the little people aren't disconnected from the old people. So the circle is there, even though English is spoken and the old language is, and there's all these kinds of problems that do happen, there is still this, always this, the babies and the old people and the moms and the dads who have to work to support all that, all help each other. And that's something that is lacking in my mainstream culture, you know, with old folks' homes separating the elders from the children who are in daycare and this crazy life where we don't eat properly and all of this kind of thing. You know, your family here is like a breath of fresh air to be able to show that, yeah, you can do this.
Yeah.
You know, it's
not
that.
Of course, we can do that.
And even, you know, across the ocean, you know.
Yeah, and it's important to know that we are spiritual beings. So we come in a family because of a reason also. So it's good to listen to each other and know what's going on, you know, really listen in our hearts. Not expecting that the person be this or that, but that we see who each one is. A new person that arrives, we see as
said that because one of my thoughts while I was being swept away earlier was our earlier discussion at Sunfrost, where you were talking about channeling. And that means a lot of things to me, because I've been involved with a variety of people who channel information or music. And I guess I want to ask you, as the American, how have you encountered how this channeling works of the music?
This for their music in particular.
And how it impacts you? How has it impacted you?
I think that just by being a part of it, listening to the music, and being a part of it, playing with them, playing this music, it's very clear to me from my own experience that this music is channeled. It's from a very high vibration. I played all kinds of music, classical music I grew up playing, and rock and jazz and all kinds of things, and part of it is where I'm at now in my own consciousness, but I hear the messages from these songs and melodies and everything, and I feel like it's channeling, healing,
and it's coming right through you too.
Like thing for me.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Mariana.
tide goes 150 miles north all the way up to Albany.
Mm-hmm.
The tide is present. It's actually from Albany south is an estuary. And the Hudson River is a very, very important river to the world because many species of fish that are food fish for people all over the world spawn here. And their specific habitats have more of them have been protected, but many of them have been lost, and we need to recover them. So the Hudson River, speaking to you, you know, it's often spoke to me because I grew up along it, further south from here, and it's a very deep connection to the world, on so many levels.
I was reading a book about Manhattan. Actually, the name of the book is Manhattan, how the Indians, the Lenape, used to call.
Manhattan, yeah.
Yeah, and saying about the species. So there was whales on the Hudson.
Yes.
Yeah, they used to come. So yeah, it's completely an ocean vibration.
I think it was a beluga whale was in the East River, which is around Manhattan, 2-3 years ago, maybe 5 years ago. And more recently, seals have been showing up. On the shores of both Manhattan and Long Island, in that very deep urban area.
So that's a good sign that not so much pollution.
Oh yeah, no, there are some success stories, and if there were things that I could say to people and that good stuff happens, and I think sometimes civilization makes laws, you know, because they kind of have to and don't really want.
So Joe, what do you think about what Lydia?
Incidentally, looking at the Hudson River, and you know, I was talking about the air quality, and he said, "Well, you know, it's gotten a lot better. The Clean Air Act of the 1970s has, you know, kind of, in spite of our growth with our economy and such, has really made a big difference in that lead has been knocked out of the air, a lot of sulfur has been knocked down out of the, you know, these are emissions, industrial and automobiles." Diesel has gotten much more efficient, and this is as an environmentalist and a native rights activist, these are kinds of things that give me impetus to keep going, keep moving forward with these ideas.
And I think the Hudson River is a really special river. I know it used to be called North River.
Yes,
it makes a lot of sense to be called North River, and. I love to see the sunset by the Hudson River. It's a fantastic experience to go there and play watching the sunset.
Do we have a way to connect this?
No, we only have 3 minutes.
Okay.
I can.
Maybe come back again and we can.
Can we do a screenshot onto it from your computer? Would that work?
Maybe show a little.
3 minutes is
part.
Very difficult. Don't do that to me.
No. Okay. All right. So we're.
I'm so happy to cooperate.
We're winding down. Are we 9 o'clock now or?
No, 8 o'clock. I'd like to start my show so I can get the DVD.
Okay. All right. So.
So we have to show, also.
But come back.
Upstate film, and upstate. Film.
Yes. And so we're gonna do that, even if it's a private screening.
Okay.
You know, we're gonna do that.
Anyway,
yeah,
the name of the film, this animation film, is called Taina Khan, the Big Star.
The Big Star.
Yeah, Taina Khan means big star in the Karajá language of these indigenous people. So this is the film that tells their beautiful legend of the Karajá people.
All right. That's great. I'd like to thank you all. You're going to have to come back sometime when you're the States, you know, look me up. I'm not going anywhere. I'll be at the theater.
Wonderful.
And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you
so
you.
Much.
All right.
For this invitation.
All right. You guys want to just do something on the way out?
Yeah,
but come
on.
Woodstock Yoga?
Yeah.
Yeah. If somebody wants to hear more, the CDs are there available.
Beautiful. Well, that wraps up a.
Do you want to give a close up?
I'm so floating on in here. There we go. And
at Woodstock
at
Yoga.
Woodstock Yoga. Song of Light.
The teacher Alison Sinatra always play songs of both of the CDs in the classes, and also Rose plays.
And if you go to cdbaby.com.
Okay.
Okay, so there we go. Nice shooting, good job.